Almighty God. Because the Lord Jesus Christ lives, we can face tomorrow. Because the Lord God lives, we have hope in Him. Father, we bless you, O God. We give you praise, everlasting God. We declare and declare your word upon our lives. We declare your finished work of preparing, O God, my Father, in every situation, O God. Because, Father, you shed your blood that you may receive life, O God. And therefore, we declare and declare hope. We decree and declare life, Almighty Father. We rejoice, everlasting Father. We will not stay down in our affliction, but we arise and rejoice, O God. Blessed be your name, O Father. We thank you, Jesus, and we give you praise and honor. Hallelujah. Psalm 83 says, the Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty. And he's armed with strength. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, O Lord. Have the seas lifted up? Yes, the seas have lifted up, O Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves, mightier than the thunder of the great waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea. The Lord on high is mighty. Your statutes stand firm. Holiness adorns your house for endless days, O Lord. Just lift up your hands and celebrate the goodness of the Lord. Give a shout to the Lord, because the Lord our God reigns. whole, as a community. Let the Lord form a hedge all around us and over everything that is called our names. Let the Lord, I pray that the Lord will form a hedge over the leadership in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to pray also in line with Isaiah 54, verse 17, which says that Isaiah 54, verse 17. Isaiah 54, verse 17 says, see, it is I, from verse 16, see, it is I who created the blacksmith, who fans the coals into flame, and forges a weapon fit for its work. And it is I who have created the destroyer to work havoc. No weapon forged against you will prevail, and you will refute every tongue that accuses you. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and this is the vindication from the Lord God. From me, declares the Lord. I want you to pray for a hedge by the Lord upon FOK as a community, upon the leadership, upon the steering team, upon the battalion leaders, upon the ministry leaders, and let us condemn every tongue that has been raised in judgment against us in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Go ahead and pray. Our Father and our God, we want to bless your name tonight. Father, we thank you because you are on the winning side, everlasting Father. Your word says in Revelation 12, 10 to 13, that they overcame by the word of the testimony and by the blood of the Lamb. And therefore, Father, we decree and declare victory. We decree the speaking of the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, my Father, upon our lives, upon the leadership of IFOK, upon every activity, upon everything, Lord, that we are involved in, Almighty God. Let the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ speak and silence every other voice in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, O God. And Father, tonight we pray and I ask that no weapon formed against us, O God, will prevail. And we condemn every tongue that has been raised against us in judgment in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, O God. Let every mark of darkness be destroyed in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you and we give you praise, glory, honor, and thanksgiving. Amen. I will just read Matthew 9, verse 16 to 17, which says that Matthew 9, verse 16 to 17, no one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch will pull away from the garment, making the tear worse. Neither do men pour new wine into old wineskins. If they do, the skins will burst, the wine will run out, and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wineskins, and both are preserved. I want to pray for ourselves with regard to this and also the garments that the Lord was giving us, that God will give us new mindset, that God will open our eyes and give us revelation regarding these garments that is clothing each and every one of us with. I believe that if you are the mountain of government, you receive your own unique garment to be able to function effectively there. If you are in the mountain of family, God will give you a garment and a dressing that is relevant. Just pray for yourself and let us pray for each one of us. Father, we thank you for your word that came to us, Lord, regarding being clothed with new garments from above, Lord. Father, it's an honor and a privilege. Holy Spirit, we thank you because you're the one who reveals to us the things that are in the secret, O God. You are the anointing that teaches us, Almighty God. Father, we pray that you give us revelation with regard to these new garments that you are clothing us with, O God. That, Father, we may not just move on with old garments that we link with the anointing that you put upon us, O God. But, Father, we pray that you will work in us, mold us, Lord, make us vessels, that you will be able to hold the need that you are pouring upon us, O God. Father, we thank you because of your mercies that are new to every morning. Thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. And wherever we are, at whatever level we are, Lord Jesus, we pray that in your grace, in your mercy, that you will adorn us, that you will clothe us, that you will equip us with a new blessing that comes with a new promise, Lord. Father, let no one be left behind, O God, but align us want to thank you for tonight. We commit this session to you, Lord. We thank you for your servant that you've prepared to this evening to come and minister to us. Our Father, we pray that your blessing will rest upon him, Lord. Your power and anointing to teach. Let the Spirit of the Lord rest upon him, O God. Let your grace be upon his life, Father. And Lord God, we pray for ourselves. Holy Spirit, we pray that you open our ears to hear your word tonight. We pray that, Lord, we will not just be here as everlasting God, but Lord, help us that you may be able to be doers of your word, even as we receive your word. Help us to put your word in practice, O God. And Father, we want to thank you even for the giving of your people tonight. Lord God, in support of the ministry of Alifoke, Father, we surrender every gifting to Lord God. We give of ourselves to Lord God Almighty. And we pray that, Lord, that our lives will be holy and set apart for you, O God. And Father, even as we also give our offerings tonight, Lord Jesus Christ, we're giving them unto you. Receive them, Lord, with thanksgiving, O God. For this is what you've given us, and we come back to say, thank you, Lord God Almighty. We give you praise and glory and honor. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Our teacher is none other than Reverend Abok Ager. Let's welcome him with a clap offering.
I'm so grateful to God for his goodness to me during this time of challenge. God is never challenged, and so we are grateful that God has kept us. Amen. So this is the prayer training program of Intercessors for Kenya Ministries, and today I am going to talk about the topic Moses, the Kingdom Builder on the Mountains of Education, Government, and Religion. My name, as you heard, Abok Ager is my name. So that is our plan for today. The objectives of this lesson are as follows. First, try to explain the various aspects of the Mountains of Education, Religion, and Government. Two, to show how Moses built the kingdom of God on those three mountains. And thirdly, to draw various lessons from the life of Moses in building the kingdom on the mountains of education, religion, and government. Just by way of introduction, a little bit of definitions. Education. Education has various definitions, but the one that I found fascinating are as follows. It is the process of facilitating learning or the acquisition of knowledge, skills, values, beliefs, and habits. Education can take place in formal or informal settings, and any experience that has a formative effect on the way one thinks, feels, or acts may be considered educational. Some of us, our education has been, many of us here, our education has been formal. You go to a classroom and you sit down and the teacher pours knowledge into your blanket, and at the end of it, your head is full of knowledge. Is that what you've gone through? The teacher assumes that when you go into the class, you don't know anything. And at the end of the class, you know everything. Education is also defined as the act or process of imparting or acquiring general knowledge, developing the powers of reasoning and judgment, and generally of preparing oneself or others intellectually for mature life. It is meant to prepare you for life. It's also the act of process of imparting or acquiring particular knowledge or skills as for a profession. So professionals, we say they are educated. They have gone to school. It's also the process of inviting truth and possibility of encouraging and giving time to discovery. It is a social process of living and not a preparation for future living, according to John Dewey, 1916. Educators look to act with people rather than on them. They act on people. I mean, they act with people rather than on them. Their task is to educe. That word is related to the Greek notion of educere, that is to bring out or develop potential. That is the work of teachers, to bring out or to develop potential in your students. Therefore, it is deliberate and hopeful. It is informed, respectful, and wise. It is grounded in a desire that all may flourish and share in life. That is education for you. And that's what we're going to be talking about. Religion, on the other hand, is the belief in and worship of a superhuman controlling power. So, all people on this earth have some religious belief. They believe in a superhuman being. And government is the political direction and control exercised over the actions of the members, citizens, or inhabitants of communities, societies, and states. It is also the direction of the affairs of state or community. So that gives you an idea of what we're going to talk about. Three mountains: the mountain of education, the mountain of religion, and the mountain of government. Now, what I'm going to share next has been shared before, but for the purpose of refreshing us, it's good for us, I'll go through it very quickly. My brothers and sisters who have spoken before have shared on these mountains, the mountain of education. According to what we have been taught and what we have been learning, the Old Testament enemy of Israel that has been associated with the mountain of education are the Amorites. You remember this teaching, right? The word Amorite means to boast or to act proudly. Therefore, pride is a major issue to contend with in the mountain of education. You know, you fill your head until you think the world is revolving around you because of some knowledge that you have known. You know, when I remember some of the things I've learned in school, I cannot feel proud because they are basic things. You know, that the people who have gone ahead of us have just made observations. For example, gravity. It looks obvious, isn't it? That if you put something here, it would go up, it would go down. That's all this guy observed, and then he made a principle out of it. Archimedes, was it called Archimedes' principle? Whatever principle it is. The ruling principality over the mountain of education is Beelzebub. You know, one time they accused Jesus of casting out demons by Beelzebub or Beelzebul. This is really another name for the devil. He is described as a demonic fly, who is also known as the Lord of the Flies. His greatest characteristic, now note that, the devil's greatest characteristic is what? To lie. He's a liar. Jesus said he's a liar from the beginning. All he knows is lies. And when he lies, that is his domain, that is his kingdom. The mountain of education has also been corrupted by many isms: liberalism, humanism, rationalism, atheism, intellectualism, and any other isms that you can think of. These are all lies of the devil that have been taught as if they were the truth. One of the greatest lies that even the founder recanted before he died is when they talked about evolution, that man actually was not created but came from apes and we are evolving. Now the greatest question is, why have we not changed for many thousands of years? We are still the same. They are not evolving. True education, therefore, should be God-centered. where pupils are taught all subjects from the perspective that God plays in those subjects. You know, I have read the Bible a bit, and I've discovered that all subjects are in the Bible. If you don't believe me, I can take you through and show you that actually you can learn mathematics from the Bible. The Bible has mathematical functions. For example, addition. Is it in the Bible?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Multiplication. Is it in the Bible?
Yes.
Division. Is it in the Bible?
Yes.
Subtraction. Is it in the Bible?
Yes.
So, that's mathematics for you. God should be the center of learning, since he is the creator of knowledge. All knowledge is God's. True knowledge is acquired from God's perspective. That is education. That is what education is. Learning from God's perspective. What about the mountain of religion? The Old Testament enemy of Israel, associated with the mountain of religion, are the Perizzites. The word Perizzite means an walled, rustic dweller. The Perizzites practice idolatry in high places, in the mountains, high places. Therefore, the Perizzites promoted false religion that did not recognize the true God. Idolatry is worshipping any other God but not the true God. The true God is the God of Israel. Their religion, who, if allowed, derailed God's purpose for Israel and the world. That's why God told Israel they must be destroyed. All these sites must be destroyed, even in our nation. The ruling principality of this mountain of religion is Satan, the enemy of God. The word Satan is derived from the Greek word Satanas, which means adversary or to oppose. He is opposed to the true worship of the true God. He desires to get the worship due to God. Just a few scriptures here. Isaiah chapter 14, from verse 12, says, "How are you fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations? For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mountain of the congregation, on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High." That's what Satan wants, to be like the Most High. "Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol. You shall be brought down to hell, to the lowest depths of the pit." That's the judgment of Satan. Upon Satan. What about Ezekiel? He still speaks about Satan. "You are the anointed cherub." Cherubim are one aspect of angels. "You are the anointed cherub who covers. I established you. You are on the holy mount of God. You walk back and forth in the midst of fiery stones." That is what Lucifer was. "You are perfect in your ways from the day you are created till iniquity was found in you. By the abundance of your training, you became filled with violence within, and you sinned. Therefore, I cast you as a profane thing out of the mountain of God, and I destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the fiery stones. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty." Those of you who are beautiful, beware. "You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I laid you before kings that they might gaze at you." So the way this mountain has been corrupted is interesting. As God's enemy, Satan promotes idolatry and a form of religion that lacks power. Easy religion. A safe religion that does not challenge him. He is also the one who has introduced false religion to take people away from worshiping the true God. To counter this, we must promote true religion that operates in spirit and in truth. If you read John chapter 4, verse 20-24, but I'll just read 23-24 says, but the hour is coming, and now is, Jesus spoke to the woman of Samaria, when true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. What about the mountain of government? The Old Testament enemy of Israel associated with the mountain of government are the Girgashites. The word Girgashite means being motivated by earthly desires or simply corruption. Is that familiar? Thus, those on this mountain must be prepared to deal with corruption to keep this mountain on track with God. We must deal with corruption. That's why there's so much corruption in our government, but we must begin to deal with it. The ruling principality is Lucifer, the prince of the nations. He's also described as the shining one, the light bearer, or the one who brings dawn or the morning star. All these features are present today, but in corrupted form. Lucifer has corrupted governance and twisted it into the pursuit for worldly desires and corrupt selfish ambitions like our own ambitions that caused him to be cast out of heaven. He controls through manipulation. So if you see what Satan is doing in government, there's a lot of manipulation. He causes nations to rise against God. In order to counter this corruption by Lucifer, believers in the government must pray intently that God would reveal to his prophets any danger that is coming into our nation. The Bible says that God does nothing except he reveals it to his servant the prophets. Amos chapter 3 verse 7. Before anything happens, God has revealed it, but we must have prophets for God to reveal these things too. One also needs to spend time in the presence of God more to have his view of things in our nation. So that is by way of background of this mountain that we are dealing with. So that when we begin to talk about Moses, how he operated on these mountains, we have an understanding of the kind of challenges that we have on these mountains. Just by way of finding out whether you have followed me, I'm going to ask questions. The ruling principality on the mountain of religion. Not the enemy, but the ruling principality. Are we in the same class? Satan. I think I'll rest my case there. All right. Now we want to look at Moses, how he operated on the three mountains, the mountain of education, religion, and government. Now, what is interesting about Moses? Moses was actually all this and more. I discovered, in fact, there was so much information that I had to suppress some because of the timing. Moses was a real actor on these mountains. As we know, Moses was born in Egypt during the time when Pharaoh of Egypt had ordered every male Hebrew child to be killed, and later on he ordered that they should be drowned, according to Exodus chapter 1 verse 16 and verse 22. And he, Pharaoh, said, when you do, he was talking to the midwives, when you do the duties of a midwife for the Hebrew women and you see them on the bath stools, if it is a son, he said, then you shall kill him. If it is a daughter, then she shall live. Later on, Pharaoh commanded his people, all his people, now not the midwives alone, all his people, every son who is born, referring to the Hebrew people, you shall cast into the river, referring to the river Nile, and every daughter you shall save alive. That was the situation in which Moses was born. In a situation where, ideally, he was already sentenced to death. He was just waiting to die. He was on death row. That was his portion, according to Pharaoh's commands. But something happened. Moses' mother saw that he was a special baby, and he made plans to save him. He first of all hid him for 3 months. Then it was now too difficult to hide him anymore after 3 months. Then he placed him in a papyrus basket among the reeds along the banks of the Nile. If you read Exodus chapter 2, verse 2 to 3. What interested me here is the role of mothers. Are there mothers in the house?
Yes.
Mothers have a critical role in bringing up their children. I found it interesting that it was the mother of Moses who saw this potential in Moses, who Moses really was supposed to be. So mothers, please, make sure that you pray over your child. Even the big ones, you can still pray. They're still your children. Pray over your child to see what God has invested in that child. Moses was to be the liberator of his people. What would have happened if the mother had failed to see the potential and save his life? What would have happened to Israel? Maybe they would have to wait for another generation, for another savior to come. But the mother saw the potential. So mothers need to seek God to know the destiny of their children and act accordingly. I'll never forget, my wife shared with me one day that one of our sons, our second son, his name is Paul. He came to the mother and said, "Mommy, I don't want to be called Paul anymore." The mother was a bit shocked and wondered, "What's the problem?" So the mother asked him, "What do you want to be called?" He said, "I want to be called David." And the mother asked, "Why?" "Mommy, because David killed a lion. Paul never killed a lion. Therefore, I want to be called David." And I wondered, because I began to realize, and later on it was confirmed by a prophetic word, God has his hand on that young man. And I began to realize, yes, something even to him, God was speaking to him. That he needed to be somebody who kills lions, a lion killer. Amen?
Amen.
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 Let us look at Moses as a leader. Moses was a leader par excellence. Is there such a word like that? He was an excellent leader. But there are some qualities that I found out that made him a good leader. Let's look at some of those qualities. The first one, and to me the most important one, is that Moses received divine call direct from God. There was a time in this nation when politicians used to say, my obedience? My allegiance is direct. In other words, they were saying they had connections with the head of state. He said, my allegiance is direct with the head of state. Therefore, they were claiming they have direct connection. They don't have to pass through somebody else. Direct call. God calling. And I believe each one of us here has had a direct call from God. God has called you. God has called your name. He called the name of Moses. Moses, Moses. He has called your name. It may not be written in the Bible, but it is written in the annals of God. You have been called. Therefore, God has invested in you. Read that scripture in Exodus chapter 3, verse 4. When Moses was looking after the animals of his father-in-law, God came down and call him by name. Man, if God calls you by name, it means God has something for you to do. God has a work for you to do. So Moses received that divine call. That set him apart. That set him apart as a leader. And nobody could take that from him. Nobody can take your call from him, because he has called you. I remember the testimony of, I have many mentors, but this one was a special mentor. This is the one who mentored me, who taught me how to preach. He even taught me how to fast. He did not put me down and teach me. He just told me to observe what he was doing. Apparently, he also mentored my wife at a different time. So we have the same mentor. And what amazed me was that he seemed to have had many problems with the established church. So he said, I may have problems with you, but there is one thing that you can never take from me, my relationship with God. You can expel me from the church, you can excommunicate me from your denomination, but there is one thing that you will never do, and that is my relationship with God. Because God called me as an individual. God called me directly. He did not consult the bishops. God did not consult the pastors to call you. No, he called you. You know, God did not consult Pharaoh when he called Moses. No, he just called Moses. Very important quality that contributes to leadership, because God is the ultimate leader. Secondly, Moses was a courageous and a prophetic leader. Courageous. Leadership needs courage to make decisions, to take the step. Those who cannot make decisions cannot be good leaders. You have to make a decision, one way or the other. Indecision is very costly. Indecision. If you cannot make a decision, it's very costly. So may God help us to be those who are courageous, to take a step. To take a step. But also, Moses was prophetic. Moses was prophetic. He was a prophetic leader. Now that takes him to a higher level. Because now he's operating in the prophetic. He's not just courageous. You know, just being courageous, you can make a lot of mistakes. But now he is taking a step because he has heard God. God has spoken to him. And he is taking that step because God has said, thus says the Lord. And he can make a declaration. And he cannot be ashamed of it. May God raise more prophets amidst us. May all of us be prophets. Paul says, when he's writing to the Corinthian church, how I wish that all of you prophesy. How I wish. He said, how I wish that you prophesy rather than speak in tongues. Nothing wrong with speaking in tongues. But Paul was talking about prophecy. He said in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verse 1, desire spiritual gifts, especially that you may do what? Prophesy. We need to be wonderful if all of us began to prophesy here. I know it is wonderful if all of us begin to speak in tongues, because that's also a gift of God. But how wonderful would it be if each one of us begins to prophesy in the name of the Lord when we come to the PTP? Moses was one of the greatest prophets of Israel. He was Israel's first national leader, if you like, president. After he led Israel out of Egyptian bondage and across the Red Sea into freedom. He laid the foundation for the nation that was based on the worship of the one true God and the laws of God. He laid the foundation. Unfortunately, many of our nations in Africa were not laid on the foundation of the true God. We laid many of our nations, the foundation of our nations, on idolatry. That's why we must redeem our nations. But Moses laid the foundation of the word of God. He is, according to Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 10, which says, but since then, he's talking about Moses, since the time of Moses, there has not arisen in Israel a prophet like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Does the Lord know you face to face? Does the Lord know me face to face? He knew Moses face to face. He is the most important of the Jewish prophets. What a leader who knows God face to face. He can face anything. Moses also was teachable. He was willing to listen to God and to work with Aaron as one whom God has sent to help him as a leader. A teachable leader is not afraid because he knows that he does not know everything. This is what God tells Moses. Is not Aaron the Levite your brother? Now you shall speak to him and put the words in his mouth. And I shall be with your mouth and with his mouth. And I will teach you what you shall do. So Moses was willing to listen to Aaron. He was willing because he is teachable. He is not afraid to be taught. One of the characteristics of a teacher is that they are also willing to be taught because they don't know everything. I remember I'm a teacher by calling, not by profession. I never trained as a teacher. But I'm a leader by calling and by gifting. Yeah. One day I was talking to some of my students and a student asked me a question. To be very frank, I did not know the answer. And I never pretended I know the answer. I tell my students, I don't know everything. So when this student asked me the question, I told him, by the way, I don't know the answer, but I promise you one thing, I'm going to find out. And I'll come back and tell you. That was what I did. Teachers don't know everything. Only God does. But God, the Bible says, a student cannot arise above his teacher, but he can be like his teacher. Is that not what Jesus said? A student can be like his teacher. You can't be like your God because you are teachable. You are willing to listen to what God is saying. Another characteristic was that Moses had access to God. God spoke to him and he spoke to God and he heard from God. There are so many scriptures that say God said this to Moses and Moses spoke this to God. I could not, there are so many, but I've listed a few there, Leviticus. A leader who has access to God can bring the problems of the people to God. You can take them to God. There are so many problems that our people have that we must take to God. Another characteristic of leadership, good leadership, is that Moses listened to good advice. Moses hearkened to the voice of his father-in-law, Jethro, about delegation. We shall be talking about delegation more shortly. Moses also ruled the people by working together with the elders. Moses was not insecure. No. He could work with anybody. He was willing to listen to good advice. According to Exodus chapter 19, it says, so Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before them all the words which the Lord commanded him. Then all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do. So Moses brought back the words of the people back to the Lord. You can see, Moses goes to the people and he comes to God. Moses made sure also that the people did all the things that God had commanded him. Exodus chapter 40 verse 33 says, so Moses finished the work. But if you look at the scripture properly, actually Moses never did anything. It is the people who did the work. But the scripture says Moses finished the work. He was willing to work with people. He was talking about the work of the tabernacle and the furnishings and the clothing for the priests. The phrase, as the Lord commanded Moses, appears many times to show that the work Moses finished was what the Lord had commanded. He only did what God commanded. He did not do other things besides. He was not a hustler. Is that such a word? He did exactly what God told him. Moses was also very meek. Have you seen this scripture in the Bible? Numbers 12 verse 13. Now Moses, the man Moses, was very humble, more than all men who are on the face of the earth. What a testimony to be a leader who is humble, who does not take the credit. It is also stated in scripture in James that God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Moses was humble. So he received a lot of grace from the Lord. May God help us to have humble leaders in our nation and in the church. Moses also was faithful as a servant. We find this in Hebrews, in God's house. He walked with God by faith. His name is in the list of the men of faith, the hall of fame of faith, in Hebrews chapter 11. Faithfulness is critical in leadership in the matters of the kingdom. Whereas it is important in our government, it is more, it is more important in the matters of the kingdom. Paul also adds his voice in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, where he tells Timothy, all the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit this to faithful men who will also be able to teach others. I trust that what we are doing here, we are entrusting the oracles of God to faithful men and women who also will be able to touch others. That is what Moses did. He invested in others. Like Miles Monroe would say, die what? Empty. Release everything that God has invested in you, so that when you die, you do not have a debt to release to people. May God raise leaders like Moses in our midst, in IFOK, in our nation, in our churches. May God raise leaders like Moses. So that's the first quality that I found in Moses. In all this mountain, in all these three mountains, Moses was a leader by excellence. In the mountain of education, he taught. And you're going to see that in a minute. Moses as an educationist. In the mountain of government, he was the leader there. And in the mountain of religion, we will see what he did. Okay. Moses as an educationist. Moses, first of all, is credited with the writing of the Torah, the law, or the first five books of the Old Testament. He is credited to be the writer. While there is no direct statement of Mosaic authorship of the Torah, tradition holds that Moses wrote them. There are some indirect statements. For example, in Deuteronomy chapter 1 verse 1 and 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 15, which sometimes are used for Mosaic authorship. For example, Deuteronomy 1:1 says, these are the words which Moses spoke to all Israel. The people who advanced this proposal say that since the Bible says that these are the words of Moses, it is most likely that he wrote them himself. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 15 says, when Paul is writing, he says, but even to this day, when Moses is read, what does that mean? When they read the writings of Moses, he says, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their hearts, referring to the law. Therefore, if we accept Mosaic authorship of the Torah, then Moses is a writer who sought to preserve the history of his people for later generations. Time has come, brothers and sisters, that we must document what God gives to us. Even these teachings, we must document them for future generations. There are people coming. Maybe out of this teaching, you are going to write more books, so that we can leave them for our children and our children's children, our grandchildren. May God help us not to lose anything that God has revealed to us. Moses commanded parents to make known, to teach, and to command God's statutes to their children. Read those scriptures. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 9, Deuteronomy 6, Deuteronomy 32. It is the responsibility of parents to teach God's truth to their children, so that the children may hear and learn to fear Yahweh. That's what it is in Deuteronomy 31, verse 13. That they may hear and learn to fear God which is always for their good, according to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 24. Deuteronomy 4, 9 says, only take heed yourself and diligently keep yourself, lest you forget the things your eyes, that was to behalf, have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life, and teach them to your children and your grandchildren. Some of us are already blessed with grandchildren. We must teach them. Deuteronomy 6, 6 and 7 says, and these words which I command you today, these words I'm speaking to you today, shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. Deuteronomy 11, 19, you shall teach them to your children, speaking of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. Everywhere we're supposed to teach. God is calling us to be teachers. Maybe not in the school, but you have a school right at home. I sometimes wonder when parents want their children, when the children come home for holidays, they want them to go back to school quickly. Whereas God is giving us an opportunity to teach them, to sit down with them. We don't have time. We are doing other things. The greatest investment you can make in the life of your children is to teach them. The teachers in school are only helping you, parents. But the responsibility is ours. The Word of God should be part of every family activity, even of schooling, particularly when we're talking about believers. Moses also received, mediated, and taught laws from God to the people of Israel. For example, the Ten Commandments. Moses received them and taught the people. These laws established and regulated relationship between God and his people and between the people of God themselves. The Ten Commandments, regulated relationship, very important. The covenant God established with Israel was forever. He said, I have established my covenant with you forever. The laws were for life and for worship. It teaches us to worship God. The relationships were based, now listen to this, on love. Deuteronomy 6 verse 4 and 5 says, hear, O Israel. This is known in other terms as the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with everything you have. Moses received this and released it to the people. He also received and taught the patterns for building the tabernacle. Moses received the pattern from God. He was told, you shall build it according to the pattern that you are shown. The tabernacle represented God's presence among his people. This shows God's desire to dwell among his people. God has always desired to dwell among his people. He told them, build even the tabernacle and the temple, so that I may dwell among you. He desires to dwell. That's why he dwells in us. We have now become the tabernacle of God, the temple of the Holy Spirit. Moses also taught God standards for obedience or for punishment. If you look at Leviticus 26 and Deuteronomy 28, the Lord has set out standards that if the Israelites obey, they will be blessed. And if they disobey, they will be punished. If you read Deuteronomy 28 verse 1, talks about the blessings. If you obey, these blessings will follow you. Verse 15 says, if you disobey, these curses will follow you. So it's us to make that choice. Moses also raised up and taught priests who were from the tribe of Levi. Number of scriptures in Leviticus. Leviticus 21 and 22 set the regulations for the conduct of priests. And you find that also in Leviticus 8 to 10. Time will not allow me to read them. Moses taught the offerings and the feasts of the Lord to the people of Israel as a lifestyle and as worship to God. That's why they were taught these things, so that they could live the kind of lifestyle that God wanted. And in doing so, they are worshiping God. But remember, there were penalties for breaking the law, both the moral and the ceremonial laws. There were penalties for breaking those laws. But one of the most critical thing that Moses teaches us is that Moses' life and ministry teaches us spiritual warfare to set nations free. That word should be free. To set nations free. Moses teaches us how to wage spiritual warfare so that we can set our nations free, so that we can set our communities free, so that we can tell Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, let my people go. That is what Moses teaches us. Moses fought, he fought Israel's enemies by God's instructions to set Israel free. For example, the war against the gods of Israel, the gods of Egypt, that is in the 10 plagues, Moses fought that war. And I discovered, brothers and sisters, Moses, like the Lord Jesus Christ, never lost any war. He didn't lose any war. Check it. It's in the Bible. Check every war that he fought. He won it. Because he fought according to the instructions that God had told him. The war against the gods of Egypt culminates in the death of the firstborn. You know the story. But he won it. In fact, at the end of it, Pharaoh was now begging him, please leave. Please leave. All the time, Pharaoh has been saying, who is that God? I don't know him. But when God, through Moses, defeated the gods of Egypt, now they were begging him to leave. What about the war against the Amalekites in Exodus chapter 17? Moses fought war in a different way. He was just on the mountain with the rod of God in his hand. And Joshua was fighting below in the valley. And as long as he lifted up his hand, they won. And you know the story. When his hand got tired, Aaron and Hur kept that hand up. And they won. They routed the Amalekites. And God told them that he will fight the Amalekites all the days. So he teaches us how to win warfare. Lift up the rod of God on the mountain. What about the war against kings Sihon of the Amorites and King Og of Bashan? He won it. That's why they took their land. All the land east of the Jordan. Moses took them and gave it to the children of who were the tribes east of the Jordan? Reuben, half the tribe of Manasseh, and Gad, yes, the 2.5 tribes, because Moses fought the battles of the Lord. God is calling us in this ministry to fight the battles of God. Don't fight any other battle that God is not fighting. God will not help you. Don't fight it. Let it go. Fight only the battles of the Lord. That's what Moses learned. He only fought the battles of the Lord. Yes, he made mistakes. He was human. But he fought the battles of the Lord. And he won every one of them. What about Moses' prayer life? This really fascinated me. I had not seen this in the Bible. Moses was a man of prayer. I have given a few examples. Times that Moses prayed. And listen to this. Many of these times, Moses prayed for Israel. He prayed for himself very few times. But let's look at them. Exodus 3-4, Moses' prayer beside the burning bush when God was instructing him to return to Egypt. He pleaded with God. What is prayer anyway? He pleaded with God. God was sending him to Egypt, but he pleaded with God. He didn't want to go. Do you know that sometimes God does not answer our prayers in the positive? Because he has a plan for you. If God answers some of our prayers, there will be great problems. Is that true? Yeah. That's why we must pray according to the will of God. So that it is in line with what God wants. Moses prayed. Moses' prayer at Rephidim regarding the water for his people to drink. They were crying, give us water. Moses prayed and the water came. Moses prayed also at Rephidim that God will give Joshua victory over the Amalekites. This is the war with the Amalekites. Moses was praying on the mountain. Joshua was not praying. Joshua was in battle. But Moses was praying. Victory comes when we spend time in prayer. I remember the prayer of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus, I have learned that actually the battle of Calvary was won in Gethsemane. When Jesus yielded to the will of the Father, he already won the battle. And that's where we must win the battle. That's where we must win the battle. Moses won it on the mountaintop. Joshua was just, you know, partaking of the results of the battle that Moses had already won on the mountaintop. What about Moses' prayer that God would forgive Israel and Aaron for worshipping the golden calf? This was one of the most terrible sins. But Moses prayed, oh God, forgive them. And he said, if you cannot forgive them, I don't think anyone of us has made such a dangerous prayer. If you cannot forgive them, then wipe out my name from the book of life. I thought about that prayer and I realized that that's a prayer that God must answer. He could not wipe out Moses' name from the book of life because of the relationship that he had with Moses. He answered that prayer. What about Moses' prayer to view God's glory in Exodus? But he said, God, show me your glory. Show me your glory. This was the cry of Moses. Show me your glory. He was not longing after the worldly gift. He was longing after the heavenly gifts, the heavenly things. Moses' prayer that God would continue to guide and protect Israel. Moses' prayer for strength and help in governing Israel. Not for himself. Moses' prayer that God would heal Miriam of leprosy when they were struck because they had a strove with Moses, Miriam and Aaron. Moses' threefold prayer for Israel, pleading with God that he would not destroy the people, following, number one, their refusal to enter the promised land. Moses prayed that God would spare Israel. Korah's rebellion, Moses prayed again. Their complaint regarding lack of water and bread, Moses prayed for them. A time that God said, just let me alone, Moses. Just let me wipe out all these guys. Hey, Moses stood in the middle and said, God, you destroy me first before you destroy these people. How many of us are willing to do that? Moses, this is the last prayer. Oh, Moses' prayer for God that he would bless his successor. What a prayer. Praying for your successor to be blessed. Many of us would rather curse our successors than pray for them. But Moses prayed for his successor. Moses' unsuccessful prayer to enter the promised land, and God told him, don't mention it again. That's the end. These prayers of Moses show the leader's love for and commitment to the people that he's leading. It is leaders. Leaders should be praying for the people. I know you guys pray for us, but our responsibility should be to pray for you, that you may grow in the things of God. What about Moses and his mentorship of Joshua? Moses raised up and mentored Joshua up to the point that Joshua was ready to take over. Moses was not afraid to raise Joshua to replace him. The mark of a leader, listen to this, is to raise up his successor. I have given you a story of one of the principals that I had in Bible school who said that whenever he took a job, he said, my first responsibility was to identify my successor and train him. And when he's ready, I quit. Even if my contract is not ended, I quit. Because there's no job for me anymore. I have already done my job. My job is to raise my successor. How many of us do that? If we did that, there would be no crisis, even in government. So Moses was not afraid. Moses sensed, this is how he raised Joshua. He sends Joshua to fight the Amalekites, but he does not send him alone. He backs him in prayer. Don't send somebody to commit suicide. Some people send you to commit suicide because they're not backing you. Moses backed him in prayer. When Moses went to God in the mountain, he went with Joshua. Joshua was Moses' assistant, or sometimes some versions say minister or even servant. You could say that Joshua was understanding Moses. The question I want to ask us, including myself, who is understanding you?
Who is understanding you? Who is going to take over from you? Have you identified that person? And you are training him. Actually, I ask myself, this question is more to me. I ask myself this question. Who is actually understanding me? And from this class, I'm going to make sure that I have somebody understanding me. Because I'm not going to be here forever. And I think you're not going to be here forever too. So what happens when you go? It seems also that Joshua was with Moses in the mountain for the 40 days. Read Numbers. 32 verse 17. Joshua would stay in the tent of meeting even when Moses returned to the camp. Moses would go back to the camp, but the Bible says his servant Joshua would stay in the tent of meeting. While Moses has gone back, that is part of mentoring. Those of you who are in the GIT, you know that very well, right? Are you sometimes left in the tent of meeting while the teacher goes back to the camp? It is not because the teacher doesn't like you. No, this is part of the training. I was told, by the way, I read a book that said that in America, in the Western world, when they want to teach babies to swim, babies, they begin, that's why they are so good swimmers. Some of us, we were starting to swim in the river when we were teenagers. It is too late. In the West, they begin with the babies, they train them to swim. And they said that the way they train babies to swim, they take them to the swimming pool and they drop them in the swimming pool. Can you imagine how cruel that is? Your baby. And they said that when you do that, listen to what happens. The baby will struggle to get himself or herself the right way up. Of course, the mother is there waiting. But the baby will struggle and make sure that the head is up. That's what happens. And that's why they learn swimming so fast. And they are very good swimmers. Sometimes we need to drop some of our trainees to the deep end. Not to kill them, but to train them. I hope you would like me to be your trainer. Or also it says that Joshua and Caleb remained loyal even when the other 10 spies rebelled against God's command to enter the land. My suspicion is that it was because of the mentorship of Moses that Joshua remained loyal. God gave Moses the command to inaugurate Joshua in those scriptures. And then Joshua and Eleazar the priest were given the responsibility of dividing the land. This was to be Moses' responsibility if he ever got into the land. He was supposed to divide the land among the tribes. But now, because he's not going to go there, he passes it on to the person he has been mentoring. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 38 tells us they were not greedy people. This was, you know, land is a problem. We have very many greedy people who have grabbed land in this nation. And I realize that land fears greedy people. Land fears greedy people. But Eleazar and Joshua were not greedy. In fact, Joshua got his inheritance last, if you check the scriptures, when he had given the others. Moses presents Joshua to Israel with confidence. According to Deuteronomy 31, verse 3 and 7, he presents him with confidence because he knew he had done the work. Moses imparts the spirit of wisdom to Joshua by laying of hands to complete the mentorship. May God help us to complete the mentorship. I'm moving towards the end. Moses and delegation. Moses had to learn delegation from his father-in-law Jethro in Exodus 18. Now, brothers and sisters, we must resist the temptation to do it all by ourselves. Nobody can. In verse 14 of Exodus 18, it says, "Why do you sit alone and all the people stand around you?" We need to resist the temptation to do it all. Secondly, he was told to ask for help. What you are doing, Jethro told him, is not good. You and the people with you will certainly wear themselves out. You cannot do it. Thirdly, release the care of absolute control. Don't be controlling.
Verse 18b says, the thing is too heavy for you. You are not able to bear it alone. Then the next thing is, start with small stuff, small things, and work your way to the harder things. Jethro advised him, every great matter they shall bring to you, but any small matter they should decide themselves. It frees you to do other things. Then Jethro tells him, endure the process. In verse 23 says, if you do this, and if God directs you, you will be able to endure, and all these people will also go to their places in peace when they are satisfied. Both parties will benefit from delegation. Qualifications of the people that they were to, that Moses was to mentor: they must be able men with ability, able men. They must fear God. They must be men of truth. They must hate covetousness. And they were to be made rulers over thousands, over hundreds, over fifties, over tens. The decision as to which one of these they ruled depended on the ability that the trainer saw in them. Some could only take 10, some could take 50. That's not a problem. That's what God has given you the gift for. Some can take 1,000. Some people have been given that ability. Moses delegated also to the 70 elders. He delegated so much that even the elders who remained in the camp began to prophesy because of his delegation. They were to help Moses to bear the burden. That's what God told him. I will take of the spirit. God said, I will take of the spirit in you and put it in the elders. And that's what God did. God took of the spirit that was in Moses. That's really what delegation is. The spirit that is in you is given to the person you are delegating to. Moses also delegated to the artisans who were building the tabernacle. Moses selected, among the artisans, he selected capable people with good character. That's what the Bible says. People who are full of the Spirit of God, full of wisdom and understanding, knowledge, and all manner of workmanship. They had also, listen to this, the ability to teach and skill. These qualities were found in both Bezalel and Aholiab, the people who were in charge of building the tabernacle. Moses did not just choose anybody. He was not tribalistic. You know, sometimes we choose people according to our tribes, even if they don't have the ability. No, they had to have those qualities. And Moses then provided them with the resources they needed to do their job, according to Exodus 36, verse 3. All the gifts that the people brought, Moses freely gave to them. Here is the gift, work. But Moses inspected the work, and their work had to meet expectations. He was not going to accept shoddy jobs. Moses took responsibility for the result. That's what delegation is about. You take responsibility for the result. The people were the first ones to be esteemed for their fine work, but later Moses also received commendation for the results. When you delegate and the people do a good job, it is you who has done it. We are seeing some of the qualities in this man Moses. In all these mountains, he is acting with quality, with distinction. Let me conclude. Oh, I have not said this. Okay. But let me now conclude. Moses truly built the kingdom of God on the mountains of education, religion, and government. He released the people from bondage from Egypt and walked with them in the wilderness for 40 years. You know, when I thought about this, I realized sometimes mentoring, delegation can take many years. For Moses, it took 40 years. Can you imagine? 40 years. He was still mentoring Joshua, preparing him to take over. I'm not sure how long Joshua lived after Moses died, but he had contact with his mentor. Mentor is the person mentoring. His mentor for 40 years. How much time have you invested in your mentees? Hey, Moses invested 40 years in Joshua. No wonder Joshua was able to lead the children of Israel to the promised land. He did not reach the promised land, but he had a hand in preparing the person who led the people there. You may not reach in certain places, but you can reach through someone. Was it not Martin Luther Jr. who said, when actually it was almost a prophetic word, he said, I have been to the mountaintop. I have seen the other side. But he said, I may not get there with you. But he was preparing the people to get there ahead of him. That's what we must do. We must leave the getting there to God. Our role is to prepare the people that God has put in our hearts. I believe God is calling us to run our race. And when we complete our love, we must hand over the baton to the persons we are prepared as we run the race. The problem that we face is, if you are having a baton in your hand and you have not prepared anybody, whom will you hand over that baton to? You may be forced to run the lap that they should have been running. We must prepare people so that the baton that we have, we can hand it over to the people that we have prepared. Otherwise, you will have nobody to hand over to. What will you do? Will you stop there or will you run the race now in place of those people that should have been running? Unfortunately, the baton seemed to have dropped after the death of the elders who outlived Joshua. That's what the Bible says in both Joshua 24 and in Judges chapter 2. Because after those elders, the Bible says, another generation arose after them who did not know the Lord, nor the work which the Lord had done for Israel. They did not know the Lord. Judges 2 verse 10b. And the nation went into corruption because there was a problem with handing over the baton. We were praying on Saturday as leadership. And this, I had prepared this message. This message was in my head as we were praying. And our leader made a statement which I'm still thinking about. He said, the baton may drop in a race. If the baton drops, what happens? You are disqualified. But in the race of life, the baton may drop, but you can still pick it up and continue running. Isn't that nice? God allows us to pick up the baton and continue running until we finish the race. That's what God has called us to. And that is, those are some of the lessons that we learn from the life and ministry of this great man of God. He was the greatest of the prophets. Yes, he did not reach the promised land. But if you read the New Testament carefully, you'll discover that actually Moses eventually arrived in the promised land. Do you know when? When he appeared with Elijah on the mountain of transfiguration, encouraging the Lord Jesus Christ. So God can make it up for you. God can make it up for you, brother, my sister. God can make it up for you. It doesn't matter if you fail. Get up. Continue the journey. May God help us. Amen and amen.